Penguin Random House Audio presents Leopard at the Door by Jennifer McVeigh. Read for you by Katharine McEwan. Chapter 1. 1952. Mombasa, Kenya. The steward has said we will dock at 9 o'clock, but I am too excited to sleep, and I walk onto deck in the dark, long before the sun comes up, watching for the first sight of land. I pull a packet of cigarettes from my coat pocket, light one and inhale, smoke curling up into the warm night sky. My heart beats out a rhythm born of long anticipation. After 6 years, I am finally coming home. The lamp casts a small pool of light onto a black metal bench. Someone has left a book behind, and I pick it up. The Settler's Guide to Upcountry Swahili, Exercises for the Soldier, Settler, Miner, Merchant, and Their Wives. I open it and cast my eye over the introduction. This book aims at teaching, in a simple way, just that degree of Swahili that is understood and talked by the average intelligent upcountry native. A curious use of adjectives, not something you would find in England. It is a long time since I have used my Swahili, and I wonder how much will come back to me. The book starts with greetings, and I turn the phrases over silently on my tongue, enjoying the familiar rhythm of the words. Jambo Bwana, Jambo Memsab, Habari Gani Hapa, Habari Mzuri Tu, Bwana. What's the news here? Only good news, master. I slip the book into my pocket, unconsciously reciting the phrases as I stare out into the dark, waiting for our arrival. An hour later, the sun rises huge and heavy from the horizon. Through a screen of mist, I make out the shadow of Mombasa Island. A couple wander onto deck, clutching cups of coffee and bread rolls, whispering excitedly. My eyes are fixed on what lies ahead. Green coconut palms and a scattering of white buildings emerge out of water so blue that I realize I have forgotten the meaning of color. The sky is clear and limitless. In England, a country in the grip of rationing, where the sun struggles to illuminate even the clearest winter day, no one has understood my descriptions of the sky in Kenya. My skin burns in the early morning sun, my neck damp beneath the weight of my hair. The white sails of the Arab dhows soar like the wings of huge prehistoric birds, their decks crammed so full of Africans, grinning and shouting, clinging to every mast, that sinking seems an inevitability. They shout up their greetings in Swahili. Karibu! Welcome. And I grin down at them, waving. We dock, and I step giddily down the gangplank into a city that smells of fish, of salt, of acrid wood smoke and sewage. The smell of a city whose people live life outdoors under a hot sun, down into the sweltering heat of the customs sheds, where I am left waiting, sweating for a few hours, before being released onto the small, crowded streets of Mombasa's port. Bougainvillea tumble over white walls, purple, orange, crimson red, amidst the trumpets of white datura flowers and clusters of pink hibiscus. Dhow captains spread their intricately woven carpets on the street for sale, beating out the dust in thick clouds. Porters in bare feet and white lungis pad across the hot cobbles between piles of old newspaper and fish bones, past the Arab men dressed in white robes who sit on low wooden stools drinking tea. I can smell roasting fish rising from a charcoal fire, tended by two sailors in brightly coloured kikoys, who stand prodding the coals, spitting out jets of red betel nut into the street, while others unload their cargo, boxes of fish, dates, henna, great piles of copper wire. Indian women in saris gossip in close groups. I stand and watch, dazzled by so much noise and colour, happiness soaring inside me. I have escaped England. I am back in Africa. But I am not home yet. There are still over 400 miles to travel, up country, before I see the farm, before I see my father. Alila! A voice says behind me, and a hand touches me on the shoulder. Alila, she cries in Swahili. It was the name the Africans had given me as a baby, when I was born healthy, after my mother had given birth to a child who never breathed. I turn and see Kahiki, our headman, standing there, his stick in one hand. Jumbo, I say, smiling as hard as I have ever smiled in my life.
Jumbo sana,
he answers, his eyes smiling back at me, grasping my outstretched hand in his sinewy one. And, just like that, I have come home. Chapter 2. We come out onto the main road, into a cacophony of beeping and shouting. There has been an accident. A truck carrying pigs has turned over in the middle of the road, and the traffic is at a standstill. A crowd of Africans gather round, watching. Tight rolls of pig flesh squeeze out of the slatted sides, their squeals sharpening the gloopy midday heat. Downers, my uncle used to call them. Pigs which were all cut up. He owns Uplands, the bacon factory which supplies Kenya's Europeans and safari outfits with the sausages, hams and pork pies that remind them of home. We nudge our way past, the pigs grunting as they struggle to find a footing on the small slither of space which forms the side panel of the truck. Those who do not find a foothold on the floor are being crushed under the weight of those on top. The truck emits a dark, dense heat, palpable with the wet stench of their panic and the dry chafing of their bristles. They must have been on their way to the train, which would take them to the factory. They'll be loaded anyway, once they get the truck back on the road, and finished off when they get there. I look away, struggling to suppress the memories which are threatening to take shape inside me. I have forgotten this other side of Kenya, a raw physicality that has no shame in the inevitability of pain. The jeep is parked just beyond the truck. Kahiki throws my luggage into the back, and I see a man of about my father's age, with a closely cut blonde beard and a dark, suntanned face, making his way through the crowd toward us. He is wearing tattered khaki shorts and desert boots, and he holds a black camera in one hand. He is broad and tall, and moves easily, though his face is creased with sun and age.
You're Rachel?
He holds out a large hand and grasps mine in his.
Nathaniel Logan.
Hi, I say, unsure why he is here. His voice has the mellow, slow drawl of an American. He is a curious mix of down at heel and well kitted out. He gets into the driver's seat, and I realize, with a swallow of disappointment, what I hadn't trusted myself to ask Kahiki, that my father has not come to meet me.
Nathaniel Logan leans over and opens the passenger door with one hand. Your father asked me to pick you up. He's stuck at the farm. They've had some trouble with the harvest.
He stows his camera in a box, then glances up at me, still standing in the street.
Hey, kiddo, it's not so bad. I won't bite.
I swing myself up into the passenger seat. Kahiki is in the back. The American starts the engine and hands me a bunch of bananas, toy size and sunflower yellow. I tear one off the bunch, peel it, and bite into an almost impossible sweetness. After 3 weeks of tinned food on the ship, the sensation of something so sun-soaked and sweet makes me catch my breath.
The truck turned over an hour ago.
Nathaniel pulls the jeep out into the road, his hand on the horn, the crowd parting to let us through. Why don't they let the pigs out?
They don't want even more of a mess.
Once we have maneuvered onto the clear road, he looks at me and smiles.
First time back in a long while?
6 years.
I'll bet you missed it like hell.
I smile back at him. He has just about summed it up. The white houses of Mombasa give way to lush vegetation, banana palms and fruit trees. He must sense the question in my silence, because he says,
I was coming as far as Nairobi anyway. I needed to buy some gear.
He gestures at the back of the jeep,
and I see a tarpaulin strapped over the boot.
Trying to keep the dust out. Damn stuff corrodes the kit.
How do you know my father?
I've been staying at Matabele.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.